The word yoga was first mentioned in the oldest sacred text, that is the Rig Veda. Yoga is an ancient physical, mental, and spiritual practice that originated in India. It is an intellectual property of India. It is a gift from India to the rest of the world. After the United Nations Declaration on 11th December 2014, every year, 21st June, is being observed as the International Day of Yoga worldwide. The International Yoga Day aims to raise global awareness of the uncountable benefits of practicing yoga. We are celebrating the second International Day of Yoga. At the time of independence in 1947, India's life expectancy was about 30 years. Today, it is more than 70 years. Though people are living longer now, but they are dying of a different set of diseases like hypertension, cancer, diabetes, etc. These diseases are complex in nature and are the result of an unhealthy lifestyle and mental stress. By adopting healthy lifestyles and better strategies for overcoming mental stress, we can prevent and treat such diseases. Yoga is a flawless combination of both the components. This realization led to the rediscovery of yoga by modern medicine in the second half of the 20th century. In India, numerous organizations like the Art of Living Foundation, Patanjali, and Sri Aurobindo's Ashram are working towards promoting yoga for the welfare of one and all. Right now, we are at the Sri Aurobindo Ashram Delhi branch to discuss these matters with Dr. Ramesh Vijlani.
Today's guest is Dr. Ramesh Vijlani, an author, doctor and writer. He has done his MBBS and MD in physiology from AIIMS. He is also a postgraduate in nutrition from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, USA. He has about 17 books to his credit and also many publications. Currently, he is the in charge of the yoga camps at Sri Aurobindo Ashram, Delhi branch. So we are delighted to have you. So we are extremely pleased and honored to meet you on the eve of the second International Yoga Day.
Thank you, so am I.
In the year 2000, you initiated a patient care facility at AIIMS for providing lifestyle modification courses based on yoga. What was the rationale behind it?
I had been in the field of nutrition in relation to cardiovascular disease and diabetes for a long time. But around the year 1990, more and more people started realizing that nutrition is just one of the several lifestyle factors that are important in relation to chronic disease. And therefore, they started looking at healthier lifestyles. And yoga being one of the finest lifestyles ever devised, many people were using yoga as a tool for management as well as prevention of chronic disease. So that's how moving from nutrition, which is one of the lifestyle factors, to the entire lifestyle, and choosing yoga as the lifestyle was a natural sort of a sequence. And further, the chronic disease, it was found, is also often associated with mental stress. And yoga combines a superb lifestyle with a very potent and infallible way of overcoming mental stress. And since yoga has both these elements, a healthy lifestyle and stress reduction, it was being extensively used at many places, and in fact we were not the first ones to do it. Therefore, it was not really sort of something unnatural to bring yoga into the All India Institute of Medical Sciences in the year 2000.
Now we are at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, that is AIIMS. Here, as we can see, the scientific research is being done to study the connection between lifestyle modifications and yoga. In 2000, Dr. Ramesh Bijlani initiated a patient care facility for providing lifestyle modification courses based on yoga. Since then, many researches have been conducted to study and determine the impact of yoga on various diseases and ailments.
Professor Bijlani was our ex-head of the department, and he initiated this process, and I must say a very different type of facility at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, that was Integral Health Clinic in year 2000. And since then, we are running this facility continuously, and now it is 2016, almost 16 years old, this facility. And initially, we used to have more of morning batches only. Nowadays, we are in fact running almost 4 to 5 batches in a day. And we have collaborations with different departments at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, like Rajendra Prasad Center for Ophthalmic Sciences. We have the collaborations with Department of Cardiology. And in fact, we are running one of the very important projects, that is multinational, international projects in Department of Cardiology, where we are dealing with the heart patients and in collaboration with UK. And this is multicentric trial. There are many centers within India, and definitely one of the important centers is All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Other than this, we are running different projects with other departments like endocrinology, especially dealing with diabetes and obesity. We are also dealing with the very important psychiatry department, and many patients with depression are being definitely given this lifestyle intervention, and they are responding very well. Now we are going to record the EEG, electroencephalography. The EEG is basically the recording of electrical activity of our brain. So here you can see the brain recording. For this, we need the different channels. Multiple channels are being used. There are the electrodes which have been connected with this machine. This you can say the EEG machine and the recording system. The different channels, this is based on basically 1020 system, the 1020 international system. And there you can see the different waves. These are basically different channels which record the, here almost we are using the 19 channels, and which will show the different activities of all over the brain. Here it is clearly visible, you can see the prominently beta waves, which simply tells the relatively active state. And in the next, you will see the relatively relaxed state, which usually we observe during the meditation. Here you can see the alpha waves. The frequency is lower, but amplitude is higher. That simply tells relatively relaxed state. As we know, the meditation is also a state where we are relatively relaxed, but definitely we are not sleeping during meditation. So this is in one of the stages. As the meditation goes on, this alpha is changed to next lower frequency waves, might be theta or delta.
Is yoga a science? What is scientific about yoga?
Yes, yoga, as I told you earlier, yoga is a lifestyle, and which may have at least two components. One is scientific and other is the philosophical approach. Being at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, we usually try to do here more and more science. Our primary objective is to find out the science in yoga, the different asanas, meditation, whatever the science or the scientific basis is, that is we are trying to find it out. And in our views, definitely there, whatever we have done research till now, it appears there is a lot of science, but still we have to do a lot of scientific research to get more and more answers.
Can yoga make a person's thyroid normal?
We have submitted one project, and that project is still under consideration. And once that project is completed, then I think I can answer this question in a better way.
How many students are drawn towards the research work of yogic practices?
Yes, we have many students who are very specifically working in the field of yoga to understand the science behind yoga. And one of the students is here, Ruchi. And she is trying to find out the cognitive functions. Can we modify the cognitive functions by yoga-based intervention? And you know, cognitive functions basically means our higher functions of the brain. Higher functions means like the judgment, the memory. We can remember something for short term or long term. The memory, the judgment, all these comes under the higher functions, or simply you can say the cognition. So cognition, can we influence by this yoga-based lifestyle intervention? And right now we are trying to find out in obese persons, in obesity. And otherwise, as I told you earlier, we are also doing the project with vitamin D. Then we are trying to find out the science, how the meditation can influence the brain, as well as now one of our recent students who has joined, he is trying to find out the genetic basis, how much it can influence the genes or the proteins. So genomics as well as the proteomics part, we are trying to touch.
Tell us about your research project.
Yeah, actually, I'm a MSc student here working under Dr. Rajkumar Yadav, and my research project is basically depends on the role of obesity and cognition and how we can modify cognition with yoga. I'm checking some parameters, I'm giving some tasks before yoga, and then after yoga, I am again measuring the task that how the yoga has affected in doing that task to the subjects. My tasks are basically, I'm giving two tasks. One is, both are cognitive tasks. One is for attention and one is for working memory. For attention, I'm basically doing a visual tracking, eye tracking, and then I'm measuring that after the yoga, is the attention is modified or not. Means the effect of yoga on attention, and second part of the cognition I'm measuring is working memory. How, and I'm giving an NBAC task for that working memory. And for working memory, I'm doing the same thing, that before yoga I'm taking the readings, and after yoga I'm taking the readings, how the readings are modified after the effect of yoga.
You talked about the attention span. So when you talk about attention span, can we improve the level of attention in OCD patients?
Yeah, definitely. We can definitely modify that. And I think someone will take up the this project and do in our lab. Mm-hmm. And we can say better when we will do the research and we will see the results. And OCD patients are also coming here for yoga, and our yoga therapist is giving some exercises for improving the attention and other parts of the cognition.
To increase my working efficiency.
वापस आएंगे हाथ उठाया रिलैक्स साइड से वापस टू थ्री फोर फाइव सिक्स फाइव सिक्स सेवन आया यस पंचम करके आया स्ट्रेच एक्सेल वापस यस चलिए एट 9, 10, relax, seated in the office,
Is yoga a science? Is there any science behind yoga?
In a way, one can say that yoga is more than science, because yoga is based on a spiritual philosophy, and spiritual philosophy is something that includes, has a very wide scope, including the mental activity which is behind science. But if by science you mean that is it based on facts? Is it based on experience? Is it based on experimentation? Yes, the methods of yoga have a remarkable resemblance to the methods used in modern science. Because any scientific investigation starts with questions, and so does the spiritual quest. And the conclusions are based on observations in both cases. The only difference is that in case of yoga, the observations have been individual observations of the mystics and the seers. Whereas in science, the observation is in a laboratory, and you can demonstrate it simultaneously to a large number of people. Right. One can't do that in yoga, the yogic experiences. But the fact that people across tradition, across geographical barriers, and over thousands of years, starting on similar quests, have reached similar observations is itself an evidence of sorts. Because the basic existential questions which the mystics start with are the origin of the universe, what is the relationship between the creator of the universe, if any, and the creation, what is the relationship between individuals in that creation, what is the unique role of human beings on this earth. In other words, the relationship between the creator, the creation, and the individuals within the creation. These questions have been pursued only by a few people at a time, at any point in history, at any place in the world. But over thousands of years, there have been enough of such people to have come to some conclusions, some of which have been recorded in writing. And when we look at those records, we find that there's a remarkable similarity between the conclusions that the rishis of the Hindu tradition reached, the Sufis of the Islamic tradition, or the mystics of the Christian and the Judaic traditions. Mm-hmm. So the fact that serious seekers, going into these questions, reached similar experiences, irrespective of the tradition, the period in history, the place in the world, itself constitutes an evidence of sorts that these observations actually correspond to a truth. This truth may not be perceived at the sensory level, but all the same, that does not make the experience itself invalid.
How can one follow yogic lifestyle in their daily lives?
Well, it depends upon how one looks at yoga. If one looks at yoga as a way of life, then it becomes a 24-hour preoccupation. But even the way it is commonly looked at, it does affect not only our physical activity, but also our diet, and to some extent in the way we live, the way we think, and in the way we deal with situations in life.
So how is yoga different from physiotherapy?
Physiotherapy is designed especially for health. Yoga is not a system of medicine designed primarily for health. Mm-hmm. Secondly, in physiotherapy, the focus is on a particular part of the body which has an injury or which is paining. And that particular part is given exercises in a graded manner, repetitive exercises. And in addition to exercises, one may also use other physical means like cold or heat or traction. As the person improves, and then more exercises may be added, a little more difficult exercises may be added, exercises against resistance may be added, but the focus is on a particular part of the body. Whereas yoga gives a comprehensive workout from top to toe and is geared more to prevention than to management of disease.
Can diseases like schizophrenia or Alzheimer's be prevented, or the effects could be limited with the help of yoga?
Yes, certainly. I mean, the more elements of yoga we use, the more we can improve health in general. particularly Alzheimer's, it is said, you know, in case of the brain, use it or lose it. So if we continue to be mentally active, it helps in preventing Alzheimer's. And yoga is a good way of keeping the mind active.
Before the year 2015, yoga was majorly popular only in India or a couple of countries in the world. But after the International Yoga Day, after it was selected on 21st of June by the United Nations, after that we've been seeing that it has become international. It has broken all sorts of barriers, all sorts of cultural and geographical barriers, and it has become an international thing. How do you perceive it?
Well, this is something which has been a process which has been going on for a long time. The declaration of the International Yoga Day by the United Nations is certainly an important landmark. It gives a sort of an official recognition to this ancient system and has also helped in making it still more popular.
Can yoga be used as a substitute for surgery or for drugs? For example, removal of kidney or gallbladder stones. Can that be done through yoga?
Well, if you're talking of surgery without, say, using anesthesia, well, those are things which only advanced yogis can go in for. But I think probably what you have in mind is using yoga as an either-or approach instead of any of the tools that modern medicine is normally associated with. In fact, in modern medicine, the way it stands today, yoga is not an either-or approach anymore. It has become an integral part of modern medicine. To give you an example, say, of high blood pressure. The drugs that we use for high blood pressure can bring it down immediately. But then along with that, if the person also starts lifestyle modification based on yoga, then gradually he will need less and less of the drug and eventually may be able to eliminate the need for drugs altogether. See, it's something like this. Suppose this room starts, has a leaky roof, and therefore the floor starts getting wet. There are two ways of keeping it dry. One is to employ somebody to keep wiping the floor so that it remains dry. The other is to repair the roof. Now, if we employ somebody to wipe the floor, he may get tired, so we get another boy to do the job. So we can have, say, three boys on 8-hour shifts keep the floor dry 24 hours. And that's something like using drugs. So we keep the blood pressure down by taking three pills a day. Each pill has a duration of action of 8 hours. But then that does not go to the root of the problem. Going to the root of the problem would mean repairing the roof. And that is what lifestyle modification does. But then going to the root always takes more time. So giving the drugs buys us that time. And then while that is being done, gradually we can also work at the roots. And when that has started getting effective, then gradually the drugs may not be necessary anymore.
You are a follower of Sri Aurobindo's yoga. What is so unique about it and what sets it apart from the other forms of yoga?
Sri Aurobindo worked out a very powerful synthesis of the major traditional schools of yoga about 100 years ago. Mm-hmm. And the reason he felt it was necessary to work out that sort of a synthesis was that around that time, and to some extent that continues even today, and therefore you can easily relate to it, mm-hmm. the focus had shifted from the spirit underlying yoga to the external forms that it had assumed. And different schools of yoga had become very rigid about their way of doing it, as well as their emphasis. For example, in Hatha Yoga, the emphasis was on physical perfection and the whole focus was on exactly how these physical practices have to be done. In Raja Yoga, the focus was on the perfection of the mind and the whole focus was on achieving the state of samadhi. Now, what Sri Aurobindo did was to go into the basic spirit underlying all these schools of yoga, as well as look at the specific benefits of the particular focus that each school had, and work out a synthesis so that the external form does not subordinate the underlying spirit. And the way he did it was, say, take the element of physical fitness, which is important because body is the material frame that forms the basis for whatever we do, including what we do with the mind. And therefore, attention to the body is important. It's a sacred duty. And This is what we took from Hatha Yoga. Then, similarly, the mind is also important because the body and the mind work together. In fact, the body-mind complex is underlying all the activities that we do. So, improving the performance of the mind is important, and therefore some elements of Raja Yoga were also taken. And at the same time, if you go to the classical texts of Hatha Yoga and Raja Yoga, the emphasis is on the terminal point, that is the perfection. And this gives a feeling that yoga is meant only for a select few. But then if you look at the yoga of the Gita, that emphasizes that yoga can be brought into everyday life. And every step that we take on the path of yoga gives us something. And therefore, it encourages everyone to take to the path of yoga.
What kind of response does Sri Aurobindo's yoga receive globally?
Sri Aurobindo's yoga is rather futuristic in nature, if you look at it as a whole. You can see it's looking at a radical transformation in human nature, which will come about as a result of the collective effort of large numbers working towards a rise in consciousness. And therefore, if you look at it in terms of numbers, the response looks limited. But at the same time, when Sri Aurobindo and the mother talked about these things 100 years ago, it might have seemed completely utopian. But now we find that some sort of a subtle change that has taken place in the atmosphere has not only made yoga more prominent as a physical practice, but more and more people are talking in terms of the rise in consciousness, not only of individuals, but collectively. And some of these people, like say, David Hawkins, or Nikki DeCarteret, or Gary Zukav, these are people who have not even read Sri Aurobindo, which is actually more significant. What it means is that this sort of a change in the consciousness is around the corner, as Sri Aurobindo and the mother had said 100 years ago, and that it is not something so utopian. And a large number of people are now talking the same language which they talked about 100 years ago, that yoga is a communal activity, and that yoga is not to be practiced in isolation, and that the world is moving in a direction that will make it a different and better place to live in.
You have authored 17 books and you also have many publications to your credit. You have given lectures at various places also. And tell us something about it.
Well, God has given me this gift of being a communicator, and I put it to use for both writing and speaking as much as I can. And that's how all this writing and speaking that I keep doing. Basically, baaton ka hi khata hun.
You've also written for children. You've written books for children. How difficult or easy was it to write books for children?
Well, I mean, it came naturally. I mean, I've not taken any specific training in writing for children, but I have sort of, again, this gift of not only communicating, but also simplifying things. Mm-hmm. So I can sometimes bring down complex things to the level of a child. Mm-hmm. Become a child, go look at it from the child's point of view, and that's how I'm able to do it.
What is the importance of pranayama?
Properly speaking, pranayama means control of the prana or the life force. But breathing being the most visible manifestation of the life force, it generally translates into control of breathing, which means breathing with a particular pattern. The pattern of breathing in which the rate, the rhythm, the depth of breathing is controlled, and the entire process is done very consciously.
Why are mantras and prayers included in a session of pranayama and asanas?
In the place of the mantras is to remind the person that yoga is more than a physical practice. It is a discipline designed primarily for spiritual growth, and that the fitness or improvement in the performance of the body and the mind that we achieve through yoga is not an end in itself. It is a means to a higher end. The purpose of this fitness is to make the body and the mind fit enough to be able to implement the divine will, to become fit enough to fulfill the purpose of life. to be fit enough to be able to do properly what we are in this world for. To make the body and the mind a fit receptacle, a fit place of dwelling for the divine within. So these are the ideas which the person is reminded of as a result of the mantras. And he is doing it not just for himself, he is doing it for all others. So to think of his divine essence and the divinity that is all around him in everything that he can see and everything that happens is what these mantras remind him about.
Can you demonstrate any of the pranayamas?
Probably I can demonstrate the king of pranayamas, the Nadi Shuddhi pranayam or the alternate nostril
whichever,
breathing.
Yeah, whichever one.
Let me demonstrate the king of pranayamas. For that we adopt Nasika mudra and then fit the nose between the thumb and the ring finger. The practice starts with breathing out through the left nostril and ends also with breathing out through the left nostril. And the change of nostril comes after each inhalation. Now this position is very convenient because just a little pressure with the thumb blocks the right nostril and just a little pressure with the ring finger blocks the left nostril. So we start with blocking the right nostril, breathe out through the left, breathe in through the left, block the left, breathe out through the right, breathe in through the right, block the right, breathe out through the left. This completes one round and one can go on like that for 10, 15, 20 rounds. For about 5 minutes one can go on, and the practice then finally ends with breathing out through the left nostril. This practice, apart from being very relaxing, also improves the concentration. And the way I look at it is that we have to keep so many things in mind, and probably that's how it improves the concentration. We have to keep in mind when to change the nostril, to breathe in such a way that breathing out takes a little longer than breathing in, and that the breathing has to be very slow and gentle, the pace has to be uniform. There's a tendency for the neck to bend forwards, that has to be avoided. So if one keeps so many things in mind, naturally concentration will improve.
Why is it known as the king of all pranayamas?
Firstly, because it is very beneficial. Secondly, it has no contraindication. Everybody can do it.
That means the other pranayamas, there are certain restrictions for people?
Yes, for some of the pranayamas, there are contraindications, particularly for Kapalabhati.
Who cannot do that?
Kapalabhati should be avoided by people who have high blood pressure or heart disease, hernia, peptic ulcer, epilepsy. And women cannot do it during menstruation, cannot be done during advanced stages of pregnancy. And also people who have pain in the neck or the back, they should also avoid Kapalabhati.
What is the significance of meditation in yoga?
The significance of meditation in yoga is to silence the surface activity of the mind so that one can look deeper within. You know, as in a swimming pool, you can't really look at the bottom unless the surface is silent. In the same way, unless the surface activity of the mind, which is normally very chaotic, becomes somewhat silent, one will not be able to go to the higher levels of consciousness, look really deep within, and access those regions of consciousness which normally remain hidden from us.
How can one handle or avoid stray thoughts during meditation?
That's one of the most difficult things to do. And it's not just your problem or my problem, it's a universal problem. And it's easy to understand because the very nature of the mind is to think. Just as, you know, the business of the heart is to beat, the business of the mind is to think. And it's not, therefore, in many systems of meditation, the emphasis is not on total silence of the mind, but on one out of two things. Either trying to just watch the thoughts, don't take interest in them, don't get involved in them, but just watch the thoughts. In some other systems, the mind is engaged in some non-analytic, repetitive, mechanical activity, so that the mind is active and yet it's not involved in anything complex, and therefore one can still look deep within. And therefore, you know, this is the first thing which you have to understand, that the mind doesn't really have to become a blank for us to be able to look deep within. What is important is what Aurobindo calls a vigilant blank, which means that the vigilance part is actually more important, and the concentration has to be calm and steady. Unlike a strained mind, in which there is a lot of stress and struggle about making the mind silent.
Why is yoga said to be union of the soul with God?
Yoga is union, all right, that's the literal meaning of the word yoga. But actually soul does not have to unite with God, because soul is already the divine essence of the individual. What unites with the soul or with the divine or with God is the body and the mind. That is the most visible part of the person, which we normally identify the person with. Normally we identify a person with his or her body and mind. And we don't think of often the soul, because it is not so obvious. But what uniting the two means is that the body and the mind, instead of working in an autonomous fashion or working under the directions of the ego, they start working more and more in light of the divine within, in light of the soul. So yoga essentially is a process of change, a process of transformation, so that the body and the mind change, transform in such a way that they are more and more tuned with the divine within, more and more in tune with the soul. And when that process of transformation has been completed, there will no longer be a discrepancy between the different aspects of the being. The most important conflict is between the head and the heart, that is the feelings and the thinking. Now that conflict can disappear in two ways. One is that the mind starts thinking a little more like, the head starts thinking more like the heart, or the heart starts thinking more like the head. But both are imperfect. So the better way of resolving this conflict would be that they both find a reference point, an anchor, which is perfect. And they both bend themselves to be in tune with that. So soul is that anchor in relation to which both the body and the mind bend as a result of yoga. They transform so that it becomes more and more natural for the mind to start like things, because basically the mind or the emotional part of the being goes after happiness. So it starts finding happiness more and more in the same things which the soul approves of. The business of the intellect is to reason. So the intellect starts finding more and more of those reasons which justify what the voice of the soul is trying to tell us. So if gradually the mind and the intellect, or the emotional part of the being and the intellect, start working in the same way, start working in tune with the soul, so that they are no longer in conflict, eventually this conflict will disappear completely. The body really is not much of a problem. The body easily falls in line. For example, if I feel hot and I start complaining, it is not the body that complains, it is the feelings that are complaining. The body just sweats and regulates the body temperature. So the body can easily fall in place. But on the other hand, yes, at a certain level, transformation of the body offers maximum resistance, which means that if we expect from the body the same type of perfection which is there in the divine, that it should show no signs of aging and decay, that, yes, is difficult at the level of the body. But for all practical purposes, what we are looking for is the transformation of the emotional part of the being and the intellect, so that they start working in tune with the soul, and that would be a union.
Can women perform yogic postures during pregnancy and menstruation?
During menstruation, they can actually continue with most of the practices, except Kapalabhati and inverted postures. During pregnancy, the best trimester is the second trimester, during which the limitations are the minimum. But even during the first trimester and the third trimester, there are a few practices which can be done, some of them with some modifications, particularly in the third trimester when the abdomen is bulging a lot. But it's not that these practices cannot be done during pregnancy. That cannot be made as a blanket statement. Of course, the opinions vary on this a lot, and probably the truth lies somewhere between the extremes. Some feel that there should be absolutely no restrictions, and some say no yogic practices during pregnancy. The truth lies probably somewhere between the two. The golden mean, as usual, is the best. Swami Vivekanand Kendra at Bangalore has done quite a bit of study on this, and in fact they have a proper protocol for what can be done during the first trimester, what practices during the second, and which practices during the third trimester.
Can yogic postures help in losing weight?
That is one of the areas where yogic postures are not very useful, because they don't consume much energy. However, having said that, they do improve the flexibility of the body, which should always precede anything more strenuous. And therefore, they can be best combined with the other more strenuous exercises. And before one goes to those strenuous exercises, one should practice yoga asanas for at least a few days, because the order in which the muscle performance should be improved is ideally first learn to relax the muscles, next improve the flexibility, and both these things are done very well by yoga. After that should come strength training, which involves repetitive movements against resistance, movements which involve weight bearing. Now all those things should come after the flexibility of the body has improved. Secondly, if you look at yoga in a comprehensive manner, then these physical practices coupled with the other changes which yoga brings about, which means that the person eats more for need rather than for greed, and he takes the food which is healthy only as much as is necessary, neither more nor less, all these things also help in losing or maintaining weight.
Do we need to follow a specific dress code for while performing the yogic asanas?
No, so long as the flexibility is limited by the body itself and not by the dress, it is fine. Any loose and comfortable dress is good for yoga.
It has to be loose and comfortable.
Yes.
Are there any postures for treating diabetes?
There is a common misconception that a few postures like Vakrasana, Bhujangasana, Dhanurasana, which involve bending the abdomen, are good for diabetes because they stimulate the pancreas. It releases insulin, and that's how diabetes improves. But it's a very superficial and a sort of crude type of reasoning, because the pancreas is not a bag of insulin which you can just press and release some insulin. You don't need insulin at any time of the day. You need it at specific timings, and the body knows when to release that insulin depending upon what is happening to the blood glucose levels. And that has nothing to do with the time at which we are doing the asanas. In fact, we did a study at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences exactly with this idea, and we found that irrespective of which asanas the person does, the diabetes improves, which means it is in fact the physical activity and other attitudinal changes that yoga is bringing about which improve diabetes, and not specific asanas. In fact, one should not be looking for specific asanas to treat a particular disease, because asanas are not like a pill. And why do we want to sort of minimize the effort to such an extent that we want to do just those few postures which will cure this disease or that disease? Because the person is not just that disease, it's a whole person. Why not use this opportunity to improve the disease that the person has, and along with that also become physically more fit? So the disease should become, in fact, an excuse or an opportunity for becoming healthier in general, rather than just trying to target one disease.
If practicing yoga, do we have to follow a particular diet regime, or do we have to eat specific foods only? Do we have to follow that?
No, strictly speaking, no. But all the same, it does help to take the so-called sattvic foods, which means foods which are good for health, and in a quantity that is just right, neither too much nor too little. Mm-hmm. And apart from what one eats and how much one eats, it's also important how one eats. So one should eat with an attitude of gratitude, and with the thought that this food should give me the health and the energy which will translate into work which I'm in this world for, work for the divine, work which will take me closer to the divine. So these are the ideas with which one should be filled while having the food.
Many people associate yoga with exercise or asana, which in fact is just one of the eight limbs of yoga. Could you please give a brief account of each of the eight characteristics of yoga, limbs of yoga?
These eight limbs have come from Patanjali's yoga. In his Yoga Sutras, he has divided yoga into these eight limbs, and the first two are yama and niyama, which are steps for self-purification. Yamas deal more with what the individual has to be in relation to others, and they are essentially a set of don'ts, things which should not be done. Ahimsa, non-violence. Now, this non-violence should be not only in action, but also in thought and word. So all these three have to be followed in thought, word, and all these yamas and niyamas are should be followed in thought, word, and deed. So not having negative or violent thoughts about somebody, not using violent language, and not, of course, indulging in physical violence. This is one. Then apart from that, asteya, non-stealing. That is not trying to have a desire to possess something which is somebody else's. Then satya, truth. Now, this looks like a positive, but one can look at it as a negative. That is not telling a lie. Then aparigraha, that is not accumulating things, that is not being greedy. And last but not least, the fifth yama is brahmacharya, which is often misinterpreted. It is generally interpreted as celibacy, but this is a limited meaning in at least two ways. Firstly, it refers not only to the act, but also to the thought and word, which are more important here than the act. Because if it were to refer to the act, then it would disqualify all married people from the practice of yoga. Now, what it means is that one should not have lustful ideas, and that applies more to the mind than to the act. And that's why, as the Bible says, if adultery has been committed in the mind, adultery has still been committed. So that is one way in which it is restricted. It's not just celibacy, it is more about the thought and word rather than the deed. Secondly, it refers not only to sex but to sensory pleasures in general. And why this antagonism towards sensory pleasures? Because you see, we treat sensory pleasures as a source of happiness. And so long as the person is just moving from one sensory pleasure to another, one fleeting pleasure to another, without realizing that these cannot be the source of lasting happiness, the person will not be able to turn towards the lasting source of happiness. And therefore, the person is not really giving up anything in brahmacharya. It is just the realization, which comes gradually, that the fulfillment of no worldly desires, the enjoyment of no sensory pleasures, can really bring lasting happiness. So as this realization comes, there comes about an inner change. And as a result of that, these things start falling off one by one. And that happens because the person now has set his eye on something much higher. So when we have set our eyes on a higher goal, then many small things cease to matter, which means that the person has not only given up these things, but in fact got detached from them. And that is how actually he can truly give them up. Because if he gives them up and gives them up with the feeling that he is missing something very enjoyable, then actually the feeling itself will nullify brahmacharya. So brahmacharya means moving towards Brahma, which means the goal is Brahma, the divine. And because the goal is high, many other small things have disappeared from this person's life. They don't interest him anymore. He doesn't look upon them as a source of happiness. So even when he is actually getting some of those things, he may enjoy them while they are there, but he's not dependent on them for his happiness. This applies to sex, and that's how a person can be married, can have children, but he's not looking upon sex as a source of pleasure. Applies even more to food, because so long as he is eating a normal diet, he likes certain things, he will not like certain things so much. But so long as this difference is not something that determines his happiness, it is quite okay. And that's why the Isha Upanishad says, tena tyaktena bhunjitha. Renounce and enjoy. Seems apparently contradictory. How can you both give up and enjoy? But actually you can truly enjoy only if you give them up internally, which means this renunciation is inner, not outer. The person has realized that these things can't be a source of happiness. So yes, as a normally constituted human being, he may like a certain taste, he may like some of these things. While they are there, he can enjoy them, that is not a sin. But then he's not dependent upon them for his happiness. So that's how you can truly enjoy. And why you can enjoy more if you have this attitude? if you have internally renounced them, because then one is not plagued by the idea, how long will it last?
Well, that's all we had in our today's interaction with Dr. Ramesh Bijlani. We hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching. Namaskar.